access only by over 325,000 marquee investors across the world. Until now.
Business news, we're news for business people. Hello and welcome to Bloomberg Quint Live, and you're watching Trend Spotting. I'm Navneet Saluja D'Souza. In the next 30 minutes, we deep dive into specific trends in the market to draw out the key takeaways and its implications for investors. But first, the headlines. Markets inch higher with both benchmark indices registering steady gains. The broader markets advance too as India Volatility Index cools off in today's session. Reliance gains after the company commissioned the world's largest refinery off-gas cracker at Jamnagar. Titan gains in trade after it forecast a robust third quarter. Brokerages give a thumbs up to the guidance as well. And the police imposes Section 144 in parts of Thane district to avoid any flare-up between Dalits and Marathas. Let's first take a look as to what's happening with the markets today. Finally, some respite coming back after the volatility that one saw in the last three trading sessions. Markets opened up. We had a gap up opening and it's been able to sustain majority of the gains. Though the Nifty did touch the 10,500 mark today. It's come off a bit from those higher levels, but it's still sitting with gains of almost 0.5% higher by 42 points. Sensex also gaining in trade today. The Bank Nifty has also seen some strength coming back. Remember, the Bank Nifty had been underperforming the Nifty right from December, but today we've seen some good gains for Bank Nifty as well, though still underperforming the Nifty, but it is gaining in today's session and it's also trading above its 50-day moving average. The market breadth is pretty good. It's in favor of the advances. The stats on the National Stock Exchange will show a clear picture. 4:1, so that's looking pretty good. Let's just also pull up the broader market indices and see what they're doing. The Nifty Small Cap Index is sitting with gains of 1% and the BSE Midcap Index is gaining almost 122 points in today's trade. Let's just pull up the Nifty contributors list and tell you which are the stocks which are contributing to the gains. Majority of them are your heavyweight stocks. So the likes of Reliance Industries, ICICI Bank, TCS, L&T, all these stocks together are contributing almost 25 points gain to Nifty in today's session. What's capping the moves on the upside then? HDFC Bank, which has almost 10% weightage on Nifty, is dragging the index lower. You've also got stocks like Infosys, Maruti Suzuki and Tata Motors. Tata Motors was actually up in yesterday's session. That's seeing some profit booking in today's trade. From the broader markets, there are a lot of stocks which are moving today and on back of some bit of news. So you've got the Nifty Metals Index, that's your top sectoral gainer. Remember, there was a report from Goldman Sachs where they've highlighted that the sector is in midst of multi-year upcycle on back of which we've seen some strong gains. And this is the index which gained almost 48% in 2017 as well. If you look at the constituents, JSW Steel is doing well after Goldman Sachs initiated a buy rating on this counter with a target price of almost 315 rupees. Titan is the other stock which has outperformed in the last few months. In fact, the stock's trading around its 52-week high levels. You've got brokerages like Goldman Sachs as well as JP Morgan where they have maintained their bullish stance on this company. Orbit Exports is the other counter. Well, we usually don't talk about the stock much, but there is some news. The company has informed the stock exchanges that the board will be taking a call on January 5th on buyback of shares. And remember, the promoter holding in this company is somewhere about 61 to 62%. So Orbit Exports is gaining almost 15% in today's session. couple of other stocks. Fertilizer stocks have seen some traction coming back. So the likes of Madras, Nagarjun, National Fertilizer, Fact, you name it, and all the fertilizer companies are gaining in today's trade. And Fortis Healthcare is your top F&O gainer in today's session. That stock seen some fresh long positions coming in today's session. That's Fortis Healthcare, which is up almost 8.5% trading around those levels of 168. That's about the markets, which are doing well. But on trend spotting today, we discuss the trends of the holiday season sales with chairman at VIP Industries, Mr. Dilip Piramal. What's the reason behind the rising demand for graphite electrodes? We get an analyst view from Samir Kalra of Target Investing. And what's in store for UFO Moviez in 2018? We ask the joint managing director, Mr. Kapil Agarwal. On to our first trend of the day then. With the holiday season just over and summer just months away, how have the players in the luggage and baggage business fared? And what kind of trends do they expect this time around? Let's ask the chairman of VIP Industries, Mr. Dilip Piramal, is joining us on the phone line. Mr. Piramal, good morning to you and thanks a lot for joining us today on Bloomberg Quint. My first question is, how has the holiday season been for a company like yours? And if you could also tell us, which are the brands in VIP Industries which have done better sales?
Oh, all our brands are doing well. We are having a very good sales. And in fact, we are falling short of some products. So I'm very happy to say that all our brands, right from Carlton, VIP, Skybags, Aristocrat and Alpha, all of them are doing quite well. And as also our Caprizi ladies handbags brand.
Okay, and where is it that you're seeing substantial pickup in volumes when it comes to your top 5 to 6 brands? And what are you reading in terms of trends there?
See, all our brands are in different segments. So, and I'm happy to say that all the segments are doing well. You know, this is one of the best times I have seen for our company in the last 10 years. And that what I mean is that all our brands are doing well, our range, and they're doing well because our products are really good throughout all the brands. And all the various distribution channels also are doing quite well. What has happened in India in the last 10 years particularly is the biggest change has come in the distribution channels, in the retail channels. Like new channels have started, you know, like the department stores, the hypermarkets, the malls, they've really entrenched in the last 10 years. And the latest, of course, is the e-commerce channel. So that has changed the business of the of every product virtually. And these are the new trends. I don't think there is anything particular as far as the consumer preferences go. And luggage, you see, luggage is a very, very sort of utilitarian type of product. So there are not too many changes happening. If you really see, even 1950s and 60s, there's one suitcase. And it's still pretty much the same thing. Only in sort of in 70 years, the only differences have been that wheels have become ubiquitous. Today, virtually all products have wheels, four wheels. And the construction of the material has changed. I mean, you get better fabrics, stronger fabrics, lighter fabrics. In the molded, in the hard luggage, you get, like, polycarbonate has become affordable. And it's a very strong plastic, and it's very light. So otherwise, there are not too many major changes in luggage. So it's not a fashion item, you know, like you can put in a few stripes here and there, but otherwise the basic product is quite similar.
Okay, sir, so the going's been good for VIP and you're also a market leader with market share of almost 52% in domestic brand name segment. Has there been any change with regard to market share? To what extent can this increase over the next 1 year with the product line?
We are not really aiming for higher market share. I mean, that is not our objective because 52% also is a very high market share. And, you know, anything, if you try to aim for anything higher than that, it becomes very expensive and it's not necessary. But let's say if our products do well and if it happens naturally, we'll be very happy. And maybe we might gain, I feel that because all our brands are doing well, we might gain a couple of points, but let us see. But that's not a very strong objective. We are looking more at our own growth sales. And market share is a competitive figure. It depends what your competition is grown by also.
What's the update in your international business, Mr. Piramal? What is it currently contributing to overall revenues?
Well, at the moment, international business is actually, its share in our total business is receding because our domestic markets are growing at about this current year, they're growing nearly 20%. Whereas our international markets are hardly growing, or in fact, they might be slightly receding. So their share is coming down. But we hope in the coming years, as our manufacturing becomes better, we will again start increasing our international business.
Okay, and also tell us, are you witnessing any sort of uptick when it comes to the input cost, since a lot of the material used in manufacturing is linked to the crude prices, which have been going up?
No, not really. On the contrary, our margins are improving because whatever price increases there, you see, we are one of the largest buyers in the luggage market. So we are able to command good prices. And so we have been able to contain the price increases to a good extent. And to that, and we are able to pass on the price increases quite easily. In fact, we can increase our prices more than our cost increases. So our margins are actually improving.
All right, Mr. Piramal, we'll leave it at that note. Thanks a lot for joining us today and giving us an outlook on what to expect from VIP industries going ahead. Remember, the stocks had a good run-up in 2017. We've seen good gains, and majority of the analysts, according to Bloomberg poll, do have a buy rating. Almost 83% of them have a buy rating and 16% have a sell rating on this counter. In the last 12 months, as you can see on your screen, the counter is up almost 183%. Well, that's about VIP industries. That's not doing much in today's session, but let's move on to the other trend of the day. The shutdown of industries due to pollution issues in China has led to a rise in demand for graphite electrodes, thus leading to a price hike. The spreads between electrode and needle coke are at record highs now. And how does this impact then players like HEG and Graphite India? Let's get an analyst view on this from Sameer Kalra of Target Investing, who joins us right here in the studio. Hi, Sameer, good morning, and thanks a lot for coming by. Well, if somebody has to talk about Bitcoin, there are definitely two stocks when you talk about Indian equities which have given a run to Bitcoins as well. And, you know, that's Graphite as well as HEG. Both of them have had a great run in 2017. By now, we obviously know the reasons. There were capacity shut down in China, both on graphite front as well as electrode. You've got steel, some steel making capacities were also shut down. I think electrodes are used in EAF method of steel making, and because of capacity shut down in China, globally the demand for steel was going up, and hence this is a sector where the only limited players globally. We've seen a good run-up. I want to know, what's the outlook for shareholders who are still holding stocks of HEG and Graphite, since we get a lot of queries, you know, on a daily basis from a couple of these retail investors. What should they do now?
So, first of all, the EAF method of production of steel accounts for 45% of the capacity worldwide. Okay, and if you see the graphite electrode capacity, that in 2010 was around 820 million MTs, million tons, except from China and Russia. That has come down to 728 last year. So if, even if you don't count the capacity constraint from China, automatically there has been 100 million tons which have vanished. This has been because of there were two international companies in Germany which were meant to shut down in 2016. So that automatically gave an edge to the prices.
Okay.
So China impact just was more like a double whammy to the prices, and that's why the prices
just shot
up.
So those two companies in Germany also shut down as well?
Yeah, so there were three plants of that firm, two plants shut down. So 100 million tons just vanished from there, except from what has estimated is around 300 million tons being shutted out from China. The production wise, if you see in 2016, if you include China, it was 439 million tons.
Right.
And if you remove China, it was 346. So there was a 100 million ton impact on the production already, which has been in 2017. So there were these two impacts which did on the pricing, which almost went up three times or four times.
But is this short-lived, Sameer? Because the factories were shut down because of environmental norms.
Yeah.
Is there
So what happened, if you go back in history of these same companies, what we are talking about today, HEG and Graphite, in 2010, similar thing happened.
2010, okay.
Yeah. So their margins went up drastically. Their revenues, since the capacity constraint was always there, the revenues didn't move up much, just because the pricing shoot,
right,
which happened 2010 because of similar actions taken by China. And they, HEG that time had 680 million capacity, which they expanded to 800 by 2013. But what happened after 2011, the prices started to come off again.
After adding the capacity?
Yeah.
Okay.
So that had a very big burn from 2011 to 2016 to the books of Graphite.
But they would be reaping HEG the benefits now of their added capacity?
Yes, they do. But the only point is, even if you see their commentary, right, they are not so convinced that these prices
will last,
firm up or stable or last so long that they need, because any capacity expansion in this industry takes 18 to 24 months.
So, which means if somebody wants to add capacity
today
so it's going to take 2 years. But that would also mean that the prices will remain at those levels,
yeah,
because the
I'm
added
saying
capacity on board is going to
so
take a lot more time.
So that's why even if you hear, especially HEG, when they talk about capacity, so for them, they can move from 800 to 1,000 million ton within 18 to 24 months with a small capex. But the only point is, even if the promoters or the management is not having an outlook to expand right now and capitalize on the, because see, shutdowns are more temporary. They are more temporary in nature. And because once they start coming up, the prices which have gone three times or four times start coming off with the same
thing. But are they running at full capacity, both Graphite and HEG?
So they are running around 85 to 90%.
And why not 100% when there's so much demand?
Every capacity which doesn't run at, especially manufacturing, if you see, it will never run at 100% capacity right now, because the only point is the labor issues.
Okay.
Because even if you do three shifts and, you know, 24/7 kind of a run, there'll be always certain bottlenecks in the manufacturing process which will reduce that capacity to be less than 100%.
Okay. Just to break all of this down, there is shortage of electrodes, and there are very few players globally, and HEG and Graphite, they control almost 20 to 25% of the world produce of that. How does it benefit them? Because when the spot prices go up, which also means the realizations for both these companies are going to look better. But how are the contracts decided? Because we try talking to the management, they don't disclose any details with regard to contracts.
So if you even go back in earlier, maybe news articles or something, you'll always find that these contracts are always 6 to 12 months. So that's why the prices, when they shot up in from June onwards, their results didn't reflect that same thing. Now these contracts are more 6 to 12 months.
So is the best yet to be reflected in the financials?
Now when the September quarter results have shown that upside of the contracts, this can last for 6 to 12 months.
Okay.
But the only negative side is they cannot increase the capacity.
Okay.
So your numbers might remain quarter on quarter stable. So you
But year on year they'll look good.
Yeah, year on year. But if you see the valuations right now, even if they do 400 crore or 500 crore, they're running on a valuation of 20 times.
I don't think we have to look at the valuations when it comes to these companies.
See, the only point is, what is the upside to that firm?
Sure.
The upside is maximum what it gained in September can be repeated in the next three or four quarters.
It's uncertain.
It's uncertain, not necessarily, because even if the spot prices come down, but the contract prices have already gone up.
Right.
So it won't just go out of their books in next two quarters. It will remain stable for 6 to 12 months.
So safe to say that next 6 months the numbers will look good?
Yes. So next two quarters, I expect the numbers to be stable quarter on quarter. And
YOY,
they'll always show
up. Obviously, they will look nice. My last question to you, Sameer, if somebody bought these stocks in December of 2016, they're sitting on huge amount of profits. What would you advise them?
See, again, if you see the fundamentals, it remains stable. So I would like to keep a hold on it. I won't see because there's a fundamental issue.
So not to buy at these levels, but you can hold on to your investment.
If you have already invested even at lower level, lower as in HGS 1000 or somewhere that, I think you should hold on to these levels.
That's the advice coming from Sameer. If somebody's invested into these counters, which were multi-baggers of 2017, that's Graphite India, almost 10 times return, even HEG, you can probably look to hold on, because if you look at the financials, according to Sameer, the next 6 to 12 months will look good. The numbers will be stable quarter on quarter, and obviously on year on year, because of higher electrode prices, the numbers will look good. Well, let's move on to our third trend of the day then, and that's on UFO Moviez, which is registering smart gains in trade today. Can we just pull up the stock and see where exactly the stock is trading? It's up almost 2%, trading around those levels of 513. Let's find out what are the key factors that's aiding this up move, and what does 2018 have in store for the company? Let's discuss this in detail with the Joint Managing Director, Mr. Kapil Agarwal, and also Saloni Dhanuka, who tracks the counter pretty closely. Saloni, over to you.
Thanks for that, Navneet. Good afternoon, sir. Let's talk about your quarter gone by. The advertisement revenue has declined quite a bit in the second quarter. Has it been on account of pricing, or was there some sort of volume cut because of GST? What is the reason for that?
Yeah, I think the impact of GST was continuing till the last quarter. So, as I have spoken earlier also to the media, Q2 and Q3 have been under stress because of the continuing impact of GST, but we foresee that the Q4 should be good to that effect. I think now the impact of GST is bearing off.
And sir, what kind of trend are you seeing on the ad revenue from the government and corporate side? Is it increasing or decreasing?
So Q2 and Q3, both corporate and the government revenues were somehow depressed. Normally, in the government side, the revenues are not depressed irrespective of the GST or anything. But somehow the revenues in Q2 and Q3 were depressed from government as well. But now suddenly we see that whole trend is reversing, both in the government as well as corporate. And both are now taking off very well.
If I may ask you, what was the reason for lower ad revenue by government side?
I think there were a lot of changes in different departments at the bureaucratic level last couple of quarters. So every time the bureaucracy changes the reshuffle happens, the decision taking slows down. Probably that could be one of the reasons. I can't find any other logical reason actually, but we saw a lot of changes happening, so probably it was the impact of that. But now, as things are stabilizing, the revenues are going back to normal, or rather they are accelerating.
And can you discuss your revenue sharing arrangement with exhibitors? How is the mix there?
So exhibitors, actually there are two sides of exhibitors. One is South India, other is the non-South India, which we call rest of the country actually. In the rest of the country, our revenue sharing arrangement generally is in the range of 25%. So 25% of advertising is shared with the exhibitors. In the South India, the revenue sharing is in the range of 10%. And the weighted average is approximately 18%. All India weighted average. However, we also give certain minimum guarantees because to the exhibitors, because as the revenue is now building up, the impact of the minimum guarantee is going down. So at one point, we were sharing almost more than 40% of the revenue with them, which now has gone down to less than 30%. So eventually, we expect it to stabilize in the range of 20-22% as the revenue grows.
So, well, talking about exhibitors and movie business, what kind of impact do you see due to delay in launches, like we have seen in case of Padmavati? How does it impact your top line, sir?
Actually, deferment of any movie is at best deferment of revenue. So, in fact, the revenue or the advertising revenue doesn't depend only on large movies. It's like you know, you look at any news channel or you look at any entertainment channel, you know, or the movie channel. The movie channel doesn't work only when the large releases come on the movie channel. So advertisers come all through the year. However, whenever there is a big movie which comes, the prices go up and we get more advertising. But otherwise, the advertising happened around the year. So, you know, if Padmavati got deferred, at best that revenue will get deferred to whenever the movie releases. However, there were other releases like Tigers in Dhaya, for example, which more than made up for that deferment. However, that revenue will be recovered whenever Padmavati or Padmavat releases.
All right, sir. And how does the content pipeline looks like in quarter four and your margin guidance for financial year 2018?
After the the debacle of advertising in last two quarters, in fact, I have been refraining from giving any guidance of the revenue. But we expect Q4 to be good and as well as 2018 to be good. In fact, if you see the content pipeline, you have for the year 2018, from January to December, we have excellent lineup of movies. All the three Khan movies are coming. There is a Salman Khan movie, Race 3. There is, you know, Thugs of Hindustan of Amir Khan. There is Zero by Salman Khan. There are two Shah Rukh Khan movies, two Akshay Kumar movies which are lined up, which is Padman and Gold. Then there is, you know, there is an excellent lineup of movies, and then of course Padmavat is likely to release in this quarter. So I think at that 2018 is seeing a very good lineup of movies, apart from movies from Siddharth Malhotra and other actors. So we do expect that the revenues should be good, and I think we'll keep coming back to the media with the exact numbers quarter on quarter.
And sir, let's talk about your merger with Cube Cinema Technologies. What are the synergies from the merger that you're seeking? And will Cube plus UFO Moviez get better pricing in the advertisement space?
Yeah, in fact, one of the prime reasons of this merger has been guided by the advertising. In fact, today, UFO has a network in around 1200 unique cities where Cube is not present. Cube has network in almost 900 cities where UFO is not present. And we have around 500 cities which are common. So overall, our network is now in approximately 2600 cities. Earlier, before this, until the merger happens, UFO was not able to provide a good network in the south, and Cube was not provided to was not able to provide good network in the rest of the country where we had prime screens. So now with this merger, actually UFO Cube combined entity will become the only medium in the country. As a matter of fact, I can even compare with the print media and the satellite TV, will be the only one which will be providing an all India network by itself, with a seating capacity of 500 crore seats per year. So today, you know, every other medium is regional. Whether you look at satellite TV, whether you look at print media, you look at anything, everything is regional. So this combination, once the merger is approved and once the merger is through, will be the only all India medium which will be which will be available across the country, which is targeted, which is impact medium. So I think this this has been, as I said, the main reason of this merger has been led by the potential growth of advertising revenue. So this is going to bring tremendous impact. That's what we expect.
It was a pleasure speaking to you, sir. Thank you for talking to Bloomberg Quint. Well, Navneet, that was the management of UFO Moviez. Quite confident about Q4 and talking about content pipeline.
Let's hope the movie Padmavati or Padmavat releases soon. Thanks a lot for that, Saloni. But I just want to switch focus back to markets, and the hotel stocks are doing pretty well. If you could just pull up EIH Associated, that's seen gains of almost 5%. You've also got stocks like Viceroy Hotel, Hotel Leela, Royal Orchid, Indian Hotels, you name it, and all these stocks have seen good gains of between 2 to 3%, but it's actually Viceroy which is registering gains of almost 11 to 12%. Well, with that, it's a wrap on this edition of Trend Spotting. Up next is Hot Money with Darshan Mehta. Stay tuned to Bloomberg Quint Live.